Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stalin's Library, A Dictator and His Books, by Geoffrey Roberts. Narrated by Stewart. Introduction. The Kremlin Scholar. This book explores the intellectual life and biography of one of history's bloodiest dictators, Joseph Stalin. Uniquely, it does so through the prism of his personal library. A dedicated reader and self-improver, Stalin's accumulation of books was a lifelong passion. In the mid-1920s, he acquired an identity for his library in the form of an ex libris stamp, Bibliotheca I.V. Stalina, the Library of J.V. Stalin. He also devised his own library classification scheme and engaged the services of a librarian. The centerpiece of his main Moscow dacha, country house, was a grand library room, though most of his vast collection was housed in an adjoining building with books delivered to him by staff. Dmitry Shepilov, who visited the dacha the day after the dictator died, recalled a large writing desk with a second desk placed against it to form a T. Both were piled high with books, manuscripts, and papers, as were the little tables around the room. Stalin himself lay dead on the couch in his library, where he had been struck down by a stroke a few days earlier. Shepilov, an economist by background, was editor-in-chief of Pravda. In 1956-7, he served as Soviet foreign minister, but lost office when he supported a failed attempt to oust from power Nikita Khrushchev, Stalin's successor, as leader of the Communist Party. Shepilov was mainly an apparatchik, and the title of the English edition of his memoirs, The Kremlin Scholar, was something of a misnomer. But it was an appellation that could more justifiably have been applied to his dead boss. By the time of his death, Stalin's library contained some 25,000 books, periodicals, and pamphlets. The collection might have been preserved intact, but the plan to turn his dacha into a Stalin museum was shelved following Khrushchev's denunciation of him and his personality cult at the 20th Party Congress in February 1956. Instead, the dictator's books were dispersed to other libraries, though important remnants and traces of his library survived in the Communist Party's archives, notably a collection of nearly 400 texts that he had marked and annotated. Rediscovered when Soviet communism disintegrated in the late 1980s, these pometki, or markings, revealed that Stalin was a serious intellectual who valued ideas as much as power. A true believer in the power of words, he read not only to learn, but also to acquire a higher communist consciousness, seen as central to the utopian goals of Soviet socialism. An ideologue, as well as an intellectual, Stalin's professed belief in Marxism-Leninism was wholly authentic, as can be seen from the library. History was Stalin's favourite subject, followed closely by Marxist theory, and then fiction. Lenin was his favourite author, but he also read and sometimes appreciated a great deal of writing by Leon Trotsky and other arch-enemies. As an internationalist, Stalin's interests were global, but he lacked command of any languages except Russian and his native Georgian, so his reading of foreign books was limited to those that had been translated. He was very interested in ancient history and preoccupied with the lessons of Tsarist rule in Russia, especially the reigns of Ivan the Terrible and the greats, Peter and Catherine. He read a good deal of military history and greatly admired Tsarist hero generals such as Alexander Suvorov, the 18th century strategist who never lost a battle, and Marshal Mikhail Kutuzov, who defeated Napoleon in 1812. More surprising, perhaps, was his fascination with Germany's Iron Chancellor, Otto von Bismarck. He also had high personal regard for other bourgeois statesmen, like fellow history buff Winston Churchill and Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the US president whose country's constitution he studied. While Stalin composed no memoirs and kept no diary, He left a well-marked literary trail, not only in the books he wrote and edited, but in those he read as well. Through an examination of these books, it is possible to build a composite, nuanced picture of the reading life of the 20th century's most self-consciously intellectual dictator. This book's first chapter, Bloody Tyrant and Bookworm, provides an overview of Stalin, the Bolshevik intellectual who revered written texts. Like all the Bolshevik leaders, he believed that reading could help transform not just people's ideas and consciousness, but human nature itself. "It is impossible to know somebody inside out," wrote Stalin to the poet Demian Bedny in 1924. "But through his library we can get to know him from the outside in. In viewing the world through Stalin's eyes, we can picture his personality, as well as his most intimate thoughts." Stalin was no psychopath, but an emotionally intelligent and feeling intellectual. Indeed, it was the power of his emotional attachment to deeply held beliefs that enabled him to sustain decades of brutal rule. Chapter 2, The Search for the Stalin Biographer's Stone, broaches the issue of his biography by examining the dictator's own sparse accounts of his early life and his responses to official efforts to construct authorized versions of his personal story. Equally important is the chapter's treatment of Stalin's extensive involvement in the project to publish his collected works. Stalin viewed his many articles, speeches, lectures, pamphlets, and booklets as a vital intellectual legacy. These were the works that he wanted to frame the writing of his biography. Incomplete at the time of his death in March 1953, the project was cancelled by Khrushchev, but the 13 published volumes remain an essential source for understanding Stalin's life and thought, not least for those biographers who view Stalin as he saw himself, as an activist, political intellectual. Chapter 3, Reading, Writing and Revolution, is dedicated to the young Stalin. It examines Stalin's formation as an underground revolutionary, paying particular attention to his education, intellectual life, and reading habits. Stalin's engagement with books began at an early age. He attended a church school and received his higher education in a seminary. He aspired to go to university to become a professor, but in the face of Tsarist oppression, opted for the life of a political activist. The book the young Stalin read and studied most intensively was, perforce, the Christian Bible. But there is no evidence his religious upbringing had any profound, long-term effects. In becoming a Bolshevik, Stalin swapped a religious faith for a secular one. But the absence of a deity in his new ideology meant that Marxism's claims to truth were rooted in science, not revelation. Stalin was as hostile to the church as any other Bolshevik, and pursued a policy of harsh anti-religious repression when he gained power. For reasons of expediency, there was a reconciliation with the Russian Orthodox Church and other faiths during the Second World War, but there is no evidence that Stalin retained any religious beliefs. The chapter ends with Stalin's appointment as the party's general secretary in 1922, and the ensuing controversy about Lenin's testament after the death of Bolshevism's founder in 1924. Stalin survived the criticisms levelled at him by Lenin in the so-called Testament, and emerged politically stronger and intellectually more confident, and his declaration to Lenin's memory was unabated. Chapter 4, The Life and Fate of a Dictator's Library, begins in 1925, and tells the story of the creation, fragmentation, and part resurrection of Stalin's personal library. It explores the dictator's reading interests and what he learned from books. It continues the treatment of Stalin's biography with a section on family life and his wife's suicide in 1932. It recounts what happened to the library after his death and summarizes the scholarly reimagining of Stalin, prompted by the rediscovery of the library's remnants. Chapter 5, Bah Humbug, Stalin's Pometki, is a detailed thematic exploration of Stalin's many marks and notes in the books he read. It begins by locating Stalin's markings within the venerable humanist tradition of writing in books as a means to assimilate new ideas and information. Stalin could be a highly active, engaged, and methodical reader. The material traces of his reading reveal his interests, thoughts, and emotional responses to the texts that he marked. Stalin's life was one long performance, in which he played many different parts. There was, certainly, an element of performance in his bookmarkings, since he must have suspected that they would become an object of study. But they are the closest we will ever get to the spontaneous Stalin, an intellectual immersed in thinking. Among the surprises of this chapter is that during the early post-revolutionary years, Stalin had a higher regard for Trotsky than most people think. After Marx, Engels, and Lenin, Stalin learned more from Trotsky than anyone else. Stalin's pometki are examined alongside the analysis of some key episodes in his biography: the intra-party power struggles of the 1920s, the Great Terror of 1937-8, the spy mania of the 1930s and 1940s, the emergence of a Soviet patriotism, military affairs, and the Great Patriotic War, and his interventions in post-war debates in philosophy, science, psychology, and linguistics. The title of Chapter 6, Reverse Engineering, Stalin and Soviet Literature, references Stalin's famous statement that the role of writers in a socialist society was to be engineers of the human soul. Stalin read a lot of fiction, and his library contained many thousands of novels, plays, and volumes of poetry. Alas, because he didn't mark, stamp, or autograph works of fiction, only a handful of these texts survived the dispersal of his library. However, from the late 1920s onwards, he had a lot to say about literature. Not only poetry, novels, and short stories, but plays and film scripts. From these remarks, it is possible to infer what kind of literature he liked and how he read it. Stalin was also an inveterate editor. Mostly, he edited documents, hundreds of which crossed his desk or passed through his office on a daily basis. But as shown in Chapter 7, editor-in-chief of the USSR, he was also involved in some notable book projects, including the revision of the post-war edition of his official short biography. In his 1956 denunciation, Khrushchev claimed Stalin embellished the biography to inflate his sense of self-importance. In reality, Stalin toned down the adulation. Even more striking was the way he reduced his personal presence in the notorious short course history of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, a party textbook that denounced his enemies as degenerates, assassins, and spies. Stalin's editing of these, and other books, was detailed enough for him to be considered a de facto co-author. Although there was nothing sophisticated about Stalin's editing, he was highly adept at marshalling material to convey simple and clear political messages. Stalin retained considerable intellectual powers to the very end of his life. "I'm 70 years old," he told his errant son Vasily, pointing to the books he was reading on history, literature, and military affairs. "Yet I go on learning just the same." By the early 1950s, however, with both his physical health and his intellect in decline, he was past his prime. Anatoly Lunacharsky, Soviet Commissar for Enlightenment in the 1920s, described himself as an intellectual among Bolsheviks, and a Bolshevik among intellectuals. The same was true for Stalin, except that he was more Bolshevik than intellectual, and lacked the skepticism that might have led him to moderate his deadly pursuit of socialist utopia. Chapter 1. Bloody Tyrant and Bookworm. A bloody tyrant, a machine politician, a paranoid personality, a heartless bureaucrat, and an ideological fanatic. To a degree, Stalin was all those stereotypes. But he was also an intellectual who devoted himself to endless reading, writing, and editing, solitary activities punctuated by the meetings he attended and the speeches he gave. Texts, written and spoken, were his world. Given the scale of his misdeeds as Soviet ruler, it is natural to imagine Stalin as a monster. To see him in the mind's eye, furiously denouncing opponents, betraying former comrades, poring over coerced confessions, ordering executions, turning a deaf ear to pleas of innocence, and coldly ignoring the colossal human costs of his communist dystopia. Moral revulsion, however, is no substitute for explaining how and why Stalin was able to do what he did. This book views Stalin through a different lens, as a dedicated idealist and as an activist intellectual who valued ideas as much as power, who was ceaseless in his own efforts at self-education, a restless mind, reading for the revolution to the very end of his life. It tells the story of the creation, fragmentation, and part resurrection of his personal library. It explores the books Stalin read, how he read them, and what they taught him. Isaac Deutscher, one of Stalin's earliest and greatest biographers, thought that his socialism was cold, sober, and rough. A key insight of this study of Stalin's life as a reader is the emotional power that imbued his ideas. In the marked books of Stalin's personal library, we can glimpse his feelings as well as the ideas to which he attached so much significance. It was not psychosis, but the vigour of Stalin's personal belief system that enabled him to initiate and sustain the barbarous methods he used to modernise and communise Soviet Russia. While Stalin hated his enemies, the bourgeoisie, kulaks, capitalists, imperialists, reactionaries, counter-revolutionaries, traitors, he detested their ideas even more. As in Al Alvarez's definition of an intellectual, Stalin was someone to whom ideas were emotionally important. This view of the nature of Stalin's intellectuality chimes with the idea that while he was an Enlightenment revolutionary, a scientific socialist who believed that socialism was a rational goal to be secured by reason, he was also a post-Enlightenment romantic who saw socialism as a human creation that could only be achieved through struggle, mobilization, and personal commitment. Because he felt so strongly about what he was trying to achieve, it is not surprising that Stalin considered emotionally charged mobilization a vital instrument to accomplish ultra-rationalist goals, and was keenly aware of the mobilizational role of the emotions. For Stalin, striving to build socialism was a highly personal and voluntaristic project, and when the results of struggle disappointed, he invariably found the people, not the cause, to be wanting. He would surely have agreed with Fidel Castro's comment that while socialism had many defects and shortcomings, these deficiencies are not in the system, they are in the people. It is sometimes said that Stalin was a psychopath, who lacked empathy for the victims of his many crimes against humanity. One death is a tragedy, a million is a statistic, is an oft-cited apocryphal statement attributed to him. It encapsulates the idea that, as an intellectual, he could both rationalize and abstract himself from his terrible rule. Actually, Stalin had a high degree of emotional intelligence. What he lacked was compassion or sympathy for those he deemed enemies of the revolution. If anything, he had too much empathy and used it to imagine the worst in people, inventing a mass of fictitious acts of betrayal and treachery, a critical ingredient of the Great Terror that swept through Soviet society in the 1930s, engulfing millions of innocent victims arrested, imprisoned, deported, or shot for political crimes. Many lesser terrors followed, culminating with the grotesque doctor's plot of the early 1950s, when scores of medics, many of them Jewish, were arrested for allegedly conspiring to murder Soviet leaders. Among those swept up in the last waves of unwarranted arrests were his longtime private secretary, Alexander Poskrebyshev, and the chief of his personal security detail, General Nikolai Vlasik, the former guardian of his young children. Like many politicians and public figures, Stalin was a subject constructed from the outside inwards, a politically driven personality, someone whose inner mental life was shaped by his public persona and by the ideological universe he chose to inhabit. Stalin was akin to a method actor
who interiorized many roles in a performance that he sustained for a lifetime. This interiorization of his political selves began with a youthful flirtation with nationalism and populism that resulted in an enduring romantic streak in his personal makeup. Then, as a hardened Bolshevik agitator and propagandist, he reinvented himself as an intelligent and practic, dedicated to enlightening and organizing the masses. His experience of the revolutionary upheavals of 1905 and 1917 habituated him to political violence. But it was the Russian Civil War, during which he implemented the harshest measures of Bolshevik repression, that inured him to large-scale loss of human life, and marked his transition from romantic revolutionary to ruthless practitioner of realpolitik. Appointed the party's general secretary in April 1922, he then positioned himself as the consummate administrator of a Soviet state apparatus that he helped create as well as serve. The Soviet regime was nothing if not bureaucratic, and what Stalin mostly read were the myriad of documents that crossed his desk every day. Yet he always found time for his personal collection of books, pamphlets, and periodicals. On documents, he scrawled decisions and directives for action. His innermost interests and feelings were reserved for the pometki, the annotations and markings he made in his library's many books. Stalin was quick to pass judgment on authors, but he respected their books. This showed in the care with which he marked and annotated them, even those of his enemies. Stalin rarely read to confirm what he already knew or believed. He read to learn something new. Affairs of state abbreviated and disrupted his reading life, but did not curtail it completely. In the midst of even the deepest national and international crises, he could be found reading, marking, and often editing this or that book. Reading for the Revolution. Stalin learned to read and annotate at school and in a seminary, but found his true métier in the radical bookshops of the Georgian capital, Tbilisi. Books converted him to socialism and guided him into the revolutionary underground of Tsarist Russia. Stalin believed in the transformative power of ideas for the simple reason that if reading had radically changed his life, then so, too, could it change the lives of others. Stalin was a voracious reader from an early age. As a young political activist and aspirant intellectual, his reading naturally focused on left-wing publications, especially the writings of Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, and of Vladimir Lenin, the leader of Stalin's Bolshevik faction in the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party. But he also devoured the classics of Russian and Western fiction, Tolstoy, Dostoevsky, Gogol, Chekhov, Shakespeare, Cervantes, Schiller, Heine, Hugo, Thackeray, and Balzac. After Lenin's death in 1924, much of Stalin's reading concentrated on the writings of his rivals in the struggle to succeed the founder of the Soviet state, people like Leon Trotsky, Grigory Zinoviev, Lev Kamenev, and Nikolai Bukharin. In the 1930s, Stalin's attention switched to Soviet literature, to the post-revolutionary writings of Maxim Gorky, Alexander Fadiev, Alexei Tolstoy, Ilya Ehrenberg, Isaac Babel, and Mikhail Sholokhov. Another preoccupation of Stalin's was the history of revolutionary movements internationally. In 1919, the Bolsheviks established the Communist International to foment global revolution. Stalin was fond of giving strategic and tactical advice to visiting foreign communists and took pride in his knowledge of other countries, much of it gleaned from books. Military strategy was an enduring interest. During the Russian Civil War, he served at the front as a Bolshevik commissar, which meant that he controlled military as well as political decision-making in his spheres of operation. Later, he collected and read the works of the foremost German, French, Russian, and Soviet strategic theorists. Not surprisingly, this interest became paramount during the Second World War, when he became the Soviet Union's supreme commander. He was particularly attentive to the experiences of his Tsarist predecessors as Generalissimo, Alexander Suvorov and Mikhail Kutuzov, both of whose portraits hung in his office during the war. Other aspects of Russian history continued to fascinate Stalin too, not least the comparisons between his rule and those of Ivan the Terrible and Peter the Great. Stalin was also attracted to the history of the ancient world, especially the rise and fall of the Roman Empire. He devoted considerable time to reading about science, linguistics, philosophy, and political economy. After the Second World War, he made a number of notable interventions in debates about genetics, socialist economics, and linguistic theory. The most notorious of these interventions was his support for Trofim Lysenko, a Soviet botanist who argued that genetic inheritance could be influenced by environmental controls. In private, however, Stalin ridiculed Lysenko's view that every science had a class character, writing on a report by Lysenko, "Ha ha ha, and mathematics? And Darwinism?" The gift of books. When Stalin's two younger sons, Vasily and an adopted son, Artem Sergiev, allowed the pages of an old and badly bound history textbook they were studying outdoors to blow apart in the wind, he collared the boys, telling them that it contained thousands of years of history, knowledge that people had shed blood to collect and store, material that scientists and historians then spent decades working on. Having insisted that Vasily and Artem glue the book back together, Stalin told them, "You did good. Now you know how to treat books." When Artem was 7, Stalin gave him a copy of Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe, and when he was 8, Rudyard Kipling's The Jungle Book. In the Defoe book, Stalin wrote, "To my little friend, Tomik, with the wish that he grows up to be a conscious, steadfast, and fearless Bolshevik." Vasily was destined to serve in the Air Force, and on his 13th birthday, in March 1934, Stalin presented him with a Russian translation of Air War, 1936, a fantasy about a future conflict between Britain and France by Major Helders, which was the pseudonym of the German aviator Robert Naus. The young Vasily was not the most diligent of pupils, preferring sports to study. In June 1938, Stalin wrote a stinging letter to one of his teachers. "Vasily was a spoilt youth of average abilities," wrote Stalin, "who was not always truthful and loved to blackmail weak leaders, even though he was weak-willed himself. He also liked to remind people whose son he was." Stalin advised the teacher to take Vasily by the scruff of his neck and not to put up with any more nonsense from him. Stalin also gave Vasily a book, whose composition he himself supervised, crafted, and edited, the canonical short course History of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, 1938, a book that was read and studied by tens of millions of Soviet citizens. Vasily read this book quite thoroughly, underlining paragraphs on virtually every page with different coloured pencils. His efforts paid off when he passed a state exam on the book with flying colours in 1939. Stalin's daughter, Svetlana, was more studious. In 1937, he gave the 11-year-old a textbook history of the USSR, and in 1938, her own copy of The Short Course. "Father commanded me to read it," recalled Svetlana, "because he wanted me to make a study of the party's history, his version of it." Unlike her brother, she never did get around to reading it. "It bored me so." And when Stalin found out, he grew very angry. But other books in her own personal collection that she did read included Lenin's Materialism and Imperio-Criticism, and Stalin's Problems of Leninism. Bolshevik book culture. Stalin's presents to his children and his stricture to Vasily and Artem about taking care of their books were expressive of the Bolsheviks' print-based political culture and their valorization of written texts. No book-burning dictator, Stalin would have sympathized with Victor Hugo's response to the communards who set fire to the Louvre Library in 1871. "Have you forgotten that your liberator is the book? The book is there on the heights. It gleams because it shines and illuminates. It destroys the scaffold, war and famine. It speaks. No more slaves and no more pariahs." Stalin and the Soviets, to use Katharina Clark's words, had an extraordinary reverence for the book, which functioned as a cult object in a secular faith. Under Stalin's tutelage, Moscow appeared to become a socialist Rome, a radical centre of world culture, based primarily, though by no means exclusively, on the printed word. After the Bolsheviks seized power in Russia in 1917, one of their first acts was to nationalise the publishing industry. For the Bolsheviks, words were the expressions of ideas that, allied to radical action, could become a material force, capable of transforming not only societies, but human nature itself. Under Stalin, Soviet writers were charged with helping to fashion the thoughts and feelings of the new Soviet men and women, constructing socialism and communism. "To build socialism, we need civil, electrical, and mechanical engineers," Stalin was reported as saying in August 1934, as Soviet writers gathered for a national congress. "We need them to build houses, automobiles, and tractors. But no less important, we need engineers of the human soul. Writer engineers, building the human spirit." According to Lenin, communism was Soviet power plus the electrification of the whole country, i.e., people's democracy and advanced industrialization. But there was also a third, critical element: mass literacy and cultural enlightenment. As Lenin said, "An illiterate person stands outside of politics and must first learn the alphabet. Without this, there can be no politics." Reading and writing were seen by the Soviet regime as a means of collective and individual self-emancipation from both bourgeois ideology and cultural backwardness, and then the achievement of a higher communist consciousness. Bolshevik leaders and activists were not exempted from this revolution of the mind. The creation of a new consciousness, attuned to the collectivist culture of the Soviet socialist system, was their personal mission, too. In power, the Bolsheviks remained committed to a permanent revolution of reading, learning, and self-improvement. They believed that under socialism, people should read a lot, and would read even more as society progressed to communism. Public libraries were to be central to the realization of Lenin's vision. He envisaged a vast network of tens of thousands of libraries, reading rooms, and mobile units that would bring books and revolutionary literature to within a 10-minute walk from every person's home. Decrees were issued to create a public library service on Swiss-American lines, quick and free access to bookshelves, interlibrary loans, long opening hours, and easy borrowing facilities. Private libraries were nationalised, together with the expropriation of major book collections owned by individuals. During the Second World War, the Nazis destroyed or ransacked 4,000 Soviet libraries, but by the war's end, there were still 80,000 of them in the USSR, with 1,500 in Moscow alone. To satisfy demand, Soviet public libraries required the printing of at least 100,000 copies of any popular book. Among the booty extracted by the Red Army from Germany at the end of the war were 13 railway wagons filled with books for Moscow University and 760,000 books for the state's main depository, the Lenin Library. By 1948, more than 2.5 million trophy books had been claimed or put on display by 279 separate Moscow cultural institutions. Lenin preferred individuals to access and read books in the controlled social environment of a public library, rather than through accumulating a personal collection. However, that preference did not apply to Bolshevik party members, who were encouraged to collect, read, and retain the authorized writings of Lenin and other Soviet leaders. The Bolsheviks were keenly aware that words could equally well be used to subvert the Soviet system as to buttress it. Censorship was abolished when they came to power, but was reintroduced in 1922. As the regime became progressively more authoritarian, an elaborate system of censorship was created to control the output of newspapers, magazines, publishing houses, and printers. The communists could not easily control what Soviet citizens thought, said, or wrote, but they could effectively control what they read. At its peak, Glavlit, the Soviet censorship organization, had many thousands of employees located in offices all over the country. It is no coincidence that the communist system collapsed in the late 1980s when Mikhail Gorbachev introduced glasnost and liberated Soviet political discourse from censorship. Gorbachev's intellectual revolution, the power of the words he unleashed, would have horrified, but not surprised, Stalin. Public libraries were subject to censorship too. From its earliest days, the Bolshevik regime sent circulars, informally known as the Talmud, to librarians, instructing them what books to remove from their shelves. In charge of the library purge during the early years was Lenin's wife, Nadezhda Krupskaya. One party directive instructed libraries to withdraw not only counter-revolutionary books, but also pro-Soviet material that articulated now out-of-date policy positions from the revolutionary and civil war period. Soviet Russia, already in 1923, was disowning its utopian past, observed Peter Knez. In 1925, the Leningrad region's censorship office banned 448 books for political and ideological reasons. Of these books, 255 had been issued by the private publishers then still in existence. Krupskaya prescribed as well as proscribed books, circulating to libraries lists of recommendations for mass consumption, especially children's literature. The Bolsheviks were particularly keen to get the masses reading the classics of fiction. In 1918, they set up a people's library of mass editions of books to be circulated free of charge. That same year, they adopted the writer Maxim Gorky's proposal to translate the classics of world literature into Russian. Gorky envisaged thousands of such translations, an ambition prosaically stymied by paper shortages during the Russian Civil War. The 1930s saw successive purges of library book stocks. In 1938-9, 16,453 titles and 24,138,799 copies of printed works were removed from libraries and the book trade network. Sometimes local censorship was so extreme it had to be curbed. In 1933, the party leadership condemned the widespread practice of organising closed stacks in libraries that had led to significant reserves of books being withdrawn from circulation. It decreed that books could only be removed from libraries upon special instruction of the Central Committee. In 1935, the Central Committee passed a resolution that curtailed the wholesale purge of libraries and the indiscriminate removal of books that was plundering and damaging library resources. It also directed that two copies of each withdrawn book were to be kept in the special library collections of a number of central libraries, academic institutions, and higher party bodies. Stalin's library. His peripatetic lifestyle as an underground revolutionary meant Stalin did not begin to collect books and build a permanent personal library until after the 1917 revolution. But his collection quickly grew to many thousands of volumes. He had an ex libris stamp that identified the books as belonging to him, but the library was more a concept than a physical reality. It never became a specific building or had a single location, as it could so easily have done. Stalin loved books for their ideas and information. He did not collect them for profit or aesthetics or as a monument to his cult image as a latter-day Renaissance man. His library was a living archive, and its holdings were scattered across various domestic and work spaces. As Paul Lafargue said of Marx, books were tools of the mind for Stalin, not items of luxury. Stalin was not alone in this endeavour. All the top Bolshevik leaders, Lenin, Trotsky, Kamenev, Zinoviev, and Bukharin, collected books. Marshal Georgi Zhukov's library reportedly contained 20,000 books, while the extensive collection of Stalin's defense commissar, Kliment Voroshilov, was lost when his dacha, country house, burned down after the Second World War. There was little danger to Stalin's collection, given the level of security and surveillance that surrounded him and his books. During the Second World War, as Hitler's armies approached Moscow, his library was boxed up and shipped to Kubyshev, Samara, in southeast Russia, where many government departments were evacuated in anticipation of the capital's fall to the Wehrmacht. Svetlana was also sent to Kubyshev, but returned to Moscow in summer 1942, recalling that Stalin's apartment was empty and depressing. My father's library was in Kubyshev, and the bookshelves in the dining room were empty. In the 1990s, the author, Rachel Polonsky, chanced upon the remnants of the library of Stalin's foremost deputy, his long-serving prime minister and foreign commissar, Vyacheslav Molotov. The books were stored in Molotov's old apartment, located just across the road from the Kremlin. In a story emblematic of post-communist Moscow, the upmarket apartment had been rented out by Molotov's grandson to an American investment banker who was a neighbour of Polonsky's. There were only a few hundred books left of Molotov's collection, but the library's surviving catalogue indicated to her there had once been 10,000. Polonsky was surprised by the eclecticism and cultural range of Molotov's books. There were, of course, various Marxist texts, together with Soviet war memoirs, books about economics and agriculture, a preoccupation of Molotov when he was Soviet premier, the Great Soviet Encyclopedia, the short course history of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, and a Russian translation of Winston Churchill's History of the Second World War. Books about Russian history and the correspondence of Tsar Nicholas II shared space on the shelves with a biography of Edgar Allan Poe and Oswald Spengler's Decline of the West. Alongside the classics of Russian literature and letters were works by Joseph Conrad, George Bernard Shaw, H.G. Wells and Anatole France, as well as Thomas Malory's Mort d'Arthur, and an illustrated edition of Dante's Divine Comedy. Stalin's library was equally diverse, and more than twice the size of Molotov's. While Molotov long outlived Stalin, dying aged 96 in 1986, he survived in office for little more than 4 years after his old boss's death. In 1957, he lost a bitter power struggle with Stalin's successor as party leader, Nikita Khrushchev. Ejected from the party leadership, Molotov was demoted to an ambassadorship in the People's Republic of Mongolia. One issue in contention between Molotov and Khrushchev was Stalin's historical legacy. While Molotov accepted that Stalin made many mistakes, he defended his constructive role in building socialism in the USSR. Khrushchev, on the other hand, wanted to denounce Stalin and the cult of his personality wholesale, and he did so at a closed session of the 20th Congress of the Soviet Communist Party in February 1956. Khrushchev's so-called secret speech sealed the fate of the dictator's personal library. A plan to turn Stalin's Moscow dacha into a museum celebrating his life was shelved, and his books mostly dispersed to other libraries. However, Soviet archivists and librarians retrieved and retained some important remnants of the library, notably nearly 400 items that Stalin had read, marked, and annotated. Preserved, too, were several thousand other books that identifiably belonged to his library. Rediscovered in post-Soviet times, these remnants came to be seen as a repository of the traces of Stalin's deepest and most intimate thoughts. Jonathan Brent's encounter with the surviving books in Stalin's library in the early 2000s verged on the religious. A Yale University press editor, Brent was in Moscow to negotiate the creation of Yale's Stalin Digital Archive, SDA, which was to contain images of all the documents in the dictator's personal file series, or Lichny Fond, as it is called in Russian. The annotated books were to be one segment of the series, and he was shown some specimens. Nobody was prepared for what we found. To see the works in his library is somehow to be brought face to face with Stalin. To see the words his eyes saw. To touch the pages he touched and smelled. The marks he made on them trace the marks he made on the Russian nation. Not a single work I inspected was not read by him. Not a single work was not copiously annotated, underlined, argued with, appreciated, disdained, studied. We see him thinking, reacting, imagining in private. Original emphasis. By the time I started to examine Stalin's library books in the 2010s, the whole collection, not just a sample, I had travelled to Moscow every year since 1996 to do research in Russian archives. I had already seen hundreds of documents composed, edited, or written on by Stalin. The novelty of trying to decipher the dictator's often unreadable scribblings had long worn off. I was interested in practicalities and particularities, not generalities. What did Stalin's Pometki actually mean? And what could they tell us about the modes and substance of his private thinking? But Brent had a point. Apart from private photographs and some hastily written and often perfunctory letters to family members, Stalin's library books are among the best means we have of accessing the dictator's inner life. In Stalin's Lichny Fond, there are many thousands of files containing tens of thousands of documents, memoranda, reports, drafts, records of conversations and handwritten notes. Invaluable to historians, though these files are, they constitute Stalin's official papers, rather than his private ones. Only in his personal library, in the way he read, marked and wrote in his books, do we get really close to the spontaneous Stalin, the intellectual, immersed in his own thoughts. The paranoia is political. Since the discovery, in the archives, of the residue of his personal library, many people have searched its holdings, hoping to glimpse Stalin's true nature, the key to the character that made his rule so monstrous. But while Stalin's books do indeed reveal his private thoughts and feelings, the key to understanding his capacity to countenance mass murder is hidden in plain sight. The politics and ideology of ruthless class war, in defense of the revolution, and the pursuit of communist utopia. Stalin's oft-noted paranoia was political, not personal. It reflected the fact that post-1917 popular support for the Bolsheviks was often flimsy, while internationally the Soviet state remained isolated and vulnerable to renewed attack by the grand coalition of capitalist powers that had already sought its overthrow during the Russian Civil War. As Stephen Kotkin put it, the problems of the revolution brought out the paranoia in Stalin, and Stalin brought out the paranoia inherent in the revolution. Apart from his writings on nationalism, Stalin's main contribution to the evolution of Marxist political theory was his propagation of the view that under socialism the class struggle intensified, an idea that derived from Lenin's writings during the Civil War. The stronger the Soviet Union became, said Stalin, the more desperate the capitalists were to crush the socialist system through a combination of external force and internal subversion. Significantly, when this concept dropped out of the Soviet political lexicon after Stalin's death, the USSR rapidly transitioned to a softer and far less violent authoritarianism. Stalin was too intelligent and self-aware to believe the panegyrics of his own personality cult. He famously chided Vasily for trading off the family name. "You are not Stalin, and I'm not Stalin. Stalin is Soviet power. Stalin is what he is in the newspapers and in the portraits. Not you, not even me." Still, there is no doubt that he saw himself as a great intellectual, and as Lenin's rightful heir, as head of state, leader of the party, and guardian of Marxist orthodoxy. The Lenin of today, as the cult slogan put it. There was no one whose books he read more assiduously and admiringly than those of Lenin. "Lenin is our teacher," Stalin proudly told the US Republican politician Harold Stassen in 1947. Stalin's personal library offers many fascinating insights into his private thinking, but more than anything, it reveals someone whose inner mental life was shaped by his public persona and by the ideological universe he inhabited. The view from his library is that from an inside window looking out. By following the way Stalin read books, we can glimpse the world through his eyes. We may not get to peer into his soul, but we do get to wear his spectacles. Stalin was a fanatic who had no secret doubts. "The most important thing is knowledge of Marxism," he scribbled in the margin of an obscure military theory journal in the 1940s. He meant it. In the thousands upon thousands of annotated pages in Stalin's library, there is not a single hint that he harbored any reservations about the communist cause. The energy and enthusiasm he applied to annotating arcane points of Marxist philosophy and economics is eloquent, and sometimes mind-numbing, testimony to his belief that communism was the way, the truth, and the future. While Stalin was undoubtedly a very dogmatic Marxist, he was not a blind prisoner of his ideology. He was capable of seeing and reaching outside the Marxian framework to engage with a diverse range of authors and perspectives. The vehemence with which he viewed his political opponents never prevented him from paying careful attention to what they wrote. Chapter 2. The Search for the Stalin Biographer's Stone. Stalin kept no diary, wrote no memoirs, and evinced little interest in his personal history. Yet he went to a great deal of trouble to shape both his biography and the documentary trail that would be followed by his biographers. It is difficult to describe the process, Stalin told an admiring American visitor, Jerome Davis, in 1926, when asked how he became a Bolshevik. First, one becomes convinced that existing conditions are wrong and unjust. Then, one resolves to do the best one can to remedy them. Under the Tsar's regime, any attempt genuinely to help the people put one outside the pale of the law. One found himself hunted and hounded as a revolutionist. Emil Ludwig, a German writer who had authored many biographies of famous people, asked Stalin a similar question in 1931 and received an equally terse and uninformative reply. Ludwig, what drove you to become a rebel? Was it, perhaps, because your parents treated you badly? Stalin, no. My parents were uneducated people, but they did not treat me badly by any means. It was different in the theological seminary of which I was then a student. In protest against the humiliating regime and the Jesuitical methods that prevailed in the seminary, I was ready to become and eventually did become a revolutionary, a believer in Marxism as the only genuinely revolutionary doctrine. In 1939, the Soviet dramatist Mikhail Bulgakov wanted to write a play about Stalin's youth, with the intention to stage it as part of the celebrations of Stalin's 60th birthday. But Stalin vetoed the project, saying that all young people are alike. Why write a play about the young Stalin? Stalin was occasionally more forthcoming about his early life, but not his childhood. It was the years he spent in the Bolshevik underground, a period that spanned his youth and early adulthood, that interested him. He loved to read and reflect on his writings from that time, and to the end of his life remained engaged with the debates, splits, strategies, tactics, and factional battles of Russia's revolutionary socialist movement. In the 1920s, he marked copiously those volumes of the first edition of Lenin's collected works that dealt with the 1905 revolution. After the Second World War, he reread with evident interest his own 1905 article on the proletarian class and the proletarian party, which had been republished in the first volume of his collected works. It was about the rules of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party, and Stalin took the trouble to write out at the end of his article the three conditions of party membership: agreement with its programme, material support, and participation in one of its organisations. Heavily marked, too, was his copy of Georgi Safarov's detailed 1923 study of the pre-1917 evolution of Bolshevik strategy and tactics. For Stalin, the party's history was not even past, let alone dead. His formative, life-changing experiences as an illegal political activist in Tsarist Russia remained eternally interesting and relevant. Speaking to visiting Indian communists in 1951, he was keen to share lessons he had learned decades earlier. He urged them to eschew the tactics of the peasant-based revolution that had recently brought the Chinese communists to power, and instead to emulate the worker-peasant alliance that had secured victory for the Bolsheviks. He warned of the dangers of premature uprisings, pointing out that in July 1917, the Bolsheviks had restrained an insurrectionary workers' movement in Petrograd because it would have been defeated by counter-revolutionary forces. He argued against individual acts of terrorism, which had the effect of dividing the progressive movement into the heroes of such actions and the crowds who cheered them from the sidelines, but did not themselves participate in revolutionary struggles. "We are against the theory of the hero and the crowd," he told them. Winston Churchill famously said in relation to Stalin's foreign policy, "I cannot forecast to you the action of Russia. It is a riddle wrapped in a mystery, inside an enigma." Less often quoted is what he said next. But perhaps there is a key. That key is Russian national interest. This was in October 1939, and Churchill was explaining to the listeners of his BBC radio broadcast why, on the eve of the Second World War, Stalin had concluded a non-aggression pact with Hitler and then joined in the German attack on Poland. Churchill's hope was that Soviet national interest and the Nazi threat would eventually lead Stalin to break with Hitler. In the event the relationship was broken by Hitler when he launched his invasion of the USSR in June 1941. The enigma of Stalin's pre-revolutionary years is that while quite a lot is known about his political views and activities, a great deal of uncertainty surrounds the details of his family life, education, personal relations, and youthful character traits. Gaps in the evidence have typically been filled in by speculation, stereotyping and cherry-picking of partisan memoirs to suit the grinding of many different personal and political axes. "When it comes to Stalin," writes the foremost biographer of his early life, Ronald Sunny, "gossip is reported as fact. Legend provides meaning, and scholarship gives way to sensationalist popular literature, with tangential reference to reliable sources." Stalin's biography. The search begins. In December 1920, Stalin hand-wrote his answers to a biographical questionnaire sent to him by the Swedish branch of Rosta, the forerunner of the TASS news agency. 1. Name: Joseph Vissarionovich Stalin, Jugashvili. 2. Year and place of birth: 1878, Gori, Tbilisi province. 3. Origins: Georgian. Father was a worker, shoemaker. Died in 1909. Mother, a seamstress, is still alive. 4. Education: excluded from the sixth, final class of the Tbilisi Orthodox Seminary in 1899. 5. How long have you been involved in the revolutionary movement? Since 1897. 6. How long have you been in the RSDLP, Russian Social Democratic Labour Party, and in the Bolshevik faction? Joined the RSDLP in 1898 and the Bolshevik faction in 1903 when it was formed. 1898, member of the Tbilisi Committee of the Party. 1903, member of the Caucasus Regional Committee of the Party. 1912, member of the Central Committee of the Bolshevik Party. 7. Were you ever a member of any other revolutionary party? No. Before 1898, I was an RSDLP sympathiser. 8. Penalties that you suffered under Tsarism: imprisonment, exile, emigration. Arrested 7 times, exiled 6 times. Irkutsk, Narim, Turkansk, etc. Escaped exile 5 times. Served 7 years in prison. Lived illegally in Russia until 1917. Was in St. Petersburg, not in emigration, but did visit London, Berlin, Stockholm, and Krakow on party business. 9. What official posts have you occupied in Soviet Russia? People's Commissar of the Workers and Peasants Inspectorate, and People's Commissar for Nationalities, member of the Council of Labour and Defence, and of the Revolutionary Military Council of the Republic, member of the All-Russia Central Executive Committee. 10. Literary activities: books, pamphlets, major articles. What newspapers and journals have you edited? Pamphlets: 1. About the Bolsheviks, in Georgian, 1904. 2. Anarchism or Socialism, in Georgian, 1906. 3. Marxism and the National Question, in Russian, 1913. Edited the Georgian Bolshevik newspaper, New Times, 1906, and Russian newspapers, the Baku Proletarian, 1908, The Star in St. Petersburg, at the time of the Lena massacre, 1912, and the Central Party organ, The Workers' Way, during the days of Kerensky in 1917. 11. Personal commitments. Currently a member of the Party Central Committee and its Org Bureau. J. Stalin. One curiosity concerns Stalin's date of birth. According to church records, he was born on the 6th of December, 1878, old-style Russian calendar, and that is the year he wrote in the roster questionnaire. However, Stalin's publicly declared birthday was the 21st of December, 1879, a new-style Russian calendar, and that was the date extravagantly celebrated at his 50th in 1929, and again in 1939 and 1949 as his 60th and 70th birthdays. The reason for this discrepancy remains a mystery, but in October 1921, Stalin completed a party registration form in which he put down 1879 as the year of his birth. The December 1922 biographical summary prepared by his staff stated that was the year of his birth, as did the opening line of a short biography prepared by Ivan Pitovstuka, documents that Stalin would certainly have read and approved. Tovstuka's text was published as one of a series of portraits of Bolshevik leaders in the so-called Granat biographical dictionary, prepared to mark the 10th anniversary of the Russian Revolution. A trusted and valued assistant, Tovstuka was a long-time revolutionary activist who started working for the future dictator when Stalin was appointed People's Commissar for Nationalities. When Stalin became Party General Secretary, Tovstuka followed him into the Central Party apparatus. Throughout the 1920s, he was one of Stalin's most important aides and performed a number of key functions, including a stint as director of the Lenin Institute, which was responsible for the publication of the first edition of Lenin's collected writings. In 1931, he was appointed deputy director of the newly created Institute of Marx, Engels and Lenin, IMEL, the party's archive-cum-research organisation. Tovstuka died of tuberculosis in 1935, but his memory was preserved by a plaque and by naming one of the archive's reading rooms after him. Stalin's Library. Tovstuka's biography of his boss, which was little more than an extended chronology of Stalin's political career, was composed at the height of the internal party succession struggle following Lenin's death in 1924. It stressed Stalin's closeness to Lenin before, during, and after the revolution. It was also published as a 14-page pamphlet, and an expanded version was published in Pravda in 1929 as one of several laudatory pieces marking Stalin's 50th birthday. Tovstuka's account was devoid of any really personal information about Stalin, and the same was true of the other Bolshevik biographies featured in the Granat. In theory, if not in always in practice, the Bolsheviks believed in self-effacement. They lived their lives in and through the collective that was the party. Their individual biographies were part and parcel of the history of the party. Their personalities and private lives were strictly subordinate to their political stories. The absence of interiority in the manner of Bildungsgroman was a matter of pride. In June 1926, Stalin went on a month-long trip to Georgia. In Tbilisi, he gave a speech to railway workers in which he summarized his pre-revolutionary political journey. As befits a former seminarian, the speech was steeped in religious imagery. It was the closest he ever came to writing an autobiography. Stalin was replying to the workers' greetings, and he began by modestly denying that he was the legendary warrior knight they thought him to be. The true story of his political life, said Stalin, was that he had been educated by the proletariat. His first teachers were those Tbilisi workers he came into contact with when he was placed in charge of a study circle of railway men in 1898. From them, he received lessons in practical political work. This was his first baptism in the revolutionary struggle, when he served as an apprentice in the art of revolution. His second baptism in the revolutionary struggle were the years 1907-9 he spent in Baku, organizing the oil workers. It was in Baku that he became a journeyman in the art of revolution. After a period in the wilderness, wanderings from one prison or place of exile to another, he was sent by the party to Petrograd, where in 1917 he received his third baptism in the revolutionary struggle. It was in Russia, under Lenin's guidance, that he became a master workman in the art of revolution. Striking about Stalin's telling of this story was that he cast it entirely in class and political terms. His Georgian background was of no consequence, except as an accidental matter of geography. His formative experiences of class struggle could have happened anywhere there were workers, and the culminating episode took place in Petrograd, the radical heartland of the Russian proletariat. "You know, Papa used to be a Georgian once," the young Vasily Stalin told his six-year-old sister Svetlana, who also recorded in her memoirs that when she was a child, her family paid no special attention to anything Georgian. "My father had become completely Russian." Tovstyuka wanted to write a full biography of Stalin, but he had rivals for that honor within the party. One of his competitors was the party official, Yemelnian Yaroslavsky, who fancied himself a historian. Among his later claims to fame was co-authorship with Stalin and others of the short course history of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, 1938, that served as the Bible of the party's history until Stalin's death. Yaroslavsky's ambition to publish a biography of Stalin was stymied by Tovstyuka and others in IMEL. When he appealed to Stalin for help in August 1935, he was given short shrift. "I am against the idea of a biography about me," wrote Stalin on Yaroslavsky's letter. "Gorky had a plan like yours, and he also asked me, but I have backed away from this issue. I don't think the time has come for a Stalin biography." The problem was that the absence of a proper, official biography was a yawning gap in a vista that Stalin himself had opened up in 1931, when he published a letter on some questions concerning the history of Bolshevism in the journal Proletarskaya Revolutsiya. Stalin's missive was a long and boring diatribe against a young historian called Anatoly Slutsky, who published an article that had the cheek to criticize aspects of Lenin's policy towards German social democracy before the First World War. Stalin denounced the article and its author as anti-party and semi-Trotskyist. Tedious and tendentious though it was, Stalin's denunciations of Slutsky was not a purely dogmatic assertion of the party line on Lenin. His criticisms were supported by a detailed textual and historical analysis of the issue. As punishment for his temerity, Slutsky was expelled from the Society of Marxist Historians and lost his post at the Communist Academy's Institute of History. He was then expelled from the Communist Party. In his letter, Stalin took the opportunity to launch a broader attack on the work of party historians, including Yaroslavsky. Who, except hopeless bureaucrats, can rely on written documents alone? Who, except archive rats, does not understand that a party and its leaders must be tested primarily by their deeds? Lenin taught us to test revolutionary parties, trends, and leaders not by their declarations and resolutions, but by their deeds. In his interview with Emil Ludwig a couple of months later, Stalin reinforced the point that in the study of history, people and their actions mattered most. When the German writer commented that Marxism denies that the individual plays an outstanding role in history, Stalin responded that Marxism does not at all deny the role played by outstanding individuals, or that history is made by people. Though, of course, they do not make history under conditions of their own choosing. And great people are worth anything at all, only to the extent that they are able to correctly understand these conditions, to understand how to change them. When Ludwig persisted with his argument, saying that Marxism denies the role of heroes, the role of heroic personalities in history, Stalin replied that Marxism has never denied the role of heroes. On the contrary, it admits that they play a considerable role. By suggesting that heroes can, by their actions, fundamentally change the existing social order, the preeminent example being Lenin's determination to stage a socialist revolution in 1917, Stalin gave a voluntaristic spin to the deterministic Marxist orthodoxy that individuals are only important insofar as they personify the historical process and act in accordance with the laws of social development. But devotees of his personality cult yearned for an edifying account of their hero's epic life story. Beria and Barbusse. The vacuum created by the absence of an authorized Stalin biography was filled by two publications. Firstly, a book-length lecture by Lavrenti Beria on the history of the Bolshevik organizations in Transcaucasia. Secondly, and more surprisingly, a semi-official popular biography of Stalin by the French communist intellectual Henri Barbusse, 1873 to 1935. Prior to becoming Stalin's security chief in 1938, Beria headed the Georgian Communist Party. The Tbilisi branch of IMEL was particularly dedicated to the study of Stalin's pre-1917 political activities in Transcaucasia, and Beria published a ghost-written article on this topic in the party's theoretical journal, Bolshevik, in 1934. In July 1935, he delivered a long lecture on the same subject to a party audience in Tbilisi. The text of his lecture was serialized in Pravda and then published as a book. Party members throughout the USSR were instructed to study it carefully. Beria sent an inscribed copy to his dear beloved teacher, the great Stalin, who read the book and marked a few of its pages, mainly underlining the dates of events that he had been involved in. As Judith Devlin writes, the book soon became a Stalin cult classic, was issued in 8 separate editions, and remained in print until Stalin's death in 1953. Beria's glowing account of the young Stalin's revolutionary activities was notable for the number of unsigned publications in Georgian that he attributed to Stalin, and for his utilization of unpublished memoirs by Stalin's old comrades and acquaintances. The limitation of Beria's rather turgid text was that, apart from Stalin, it was populated by personages that few people had ever heard of or cared about, and dealt with equally obscure events. Henri Barbusse was a famous pacifist and anti-war writer. A member of the French Communist Party from 1923, he helped organize the 1932 Amsterdam World Congress against war, and headed the World Committee Against War and Fascism, founded in 1933. While Stalin conversed with a number of prominent Western intellectuals in the 1930s, Barbusse was the only one he met in the 1920s as well. Stalin talked to Barbusse 4 times, in September 1927, October 1932, August 1933, and November 1934. "I'm not so busy that I can't find time to talk to Comrade Barbusse," Stalin remarked at their 1932 meeting. The idea of writing a biography of Stalin was prompted by conversations that Barbusse had with the communist propaganda impresario Willy Munzenberg, a German revolutionary who worked for the Moscow-based Communist International, Comintern, established by the Bolsheviks in March 1919 to spread the revolution. In December 1932, the Soviet Party's propaganda...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.